فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
Did Allah, what sin did Allah mean by this? A shirk. Shirk. Are you with me, brothers? So when you understanding the Quran, Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah telling you to understand the Quran based on what? Ma arad Allah, that which Allah intended by it, and that which the Messenger intended by it. Not what you intended by it, or what you understood from the Quran. And no, wallahi, the Quran doesn't need no reform. It does not need it. The Quran does not need you to come and tamper with it and reinterpret it. It does not need that from you. The Quran has been set, its rules and regulations are put in place. Are you following the rules for it like it? That's the problem. And the second way that you're going to understand the Quran and the Sunnah, that Ahlul Sunnah tell you is, مَا قَالَهُ الصَّحَابَةُ. What did the companion say about this verse? What did the Sahaba say about this? What did the students of the Sahabas say about this? Why? Why? Pay attention. Because فَإِنَّ الرَّسُولَ لَمَّا خَاطَبَهُمُ الْكِتَابُ وَالسُّدَّ عَرَفَهُمْ مَا أَرَادَ بِتِلْكَ الْأَلْفَاظِ. They understood what the Prophet meant by those words. That was their language. They were the Arabs. The language that was being spoken, they understood it. What helped them, the Sahabas as well, was the fact that the revelation was coming down in a circumstances which they could relate to. Are you with me? It came down in their environment, in their land. They knew the temperature that day and the heat, the way it was. They know how the environment felt that day. They know how the faces of the companions looked that day. They know the Prophet ﷺ, when he said that verse, was he smiling, was he angry? They know every details regarding it, which supports the understanding of the verse. Sah? They saw the Prophet ﷺ in a crime scene. Whose statement does a police officer take? The eyewitness. The police officer will take the statement of the eyewitnesses, those who were there when the incident happened, not those who came months, weeks later. The Sahabas are the eyewitnesses. They saw the incidents happen and that which took place. So we need to know and we want to get narrations of how they understood this particular verse and how they understood this particular hadith. Also, the Sahabas didn't have this hidden agenda. They didn't have it, like it creeped into the later generation. They had the greatest form of piety and taqwa. So when they understood the verse, it was stripped from desires. There was no desires involved. Other people are taking the verse in accordance to their desires. Sahaba to Rasulullah did not have that. The language of the Arabic didn't dilute. It didn't wear out. That it changed as time went by. That here we are with one word. It has six different meanings because as time came by, it started to change. They have it in the purest essence of that word and what it used to be at the time of the Prophet ﷺ. Radiallahu ta'ala anhum. The biggest way to tackle these extremist ideologies are by those who are taking those points. Because those Khawarij are not. They are not Ahlul Ara, they're not opinionated. In a sense where they're not Ahlul Ra'i, they're not people of opinion. They were always people who would bring Adil and Nuqul and evidences that was misunderstood. Evidences that were corrupted, in which they were corrupted in its understanding. Meaning, the Khawarij were not like, when I say Ahlul Ra'i, I mean by, they were not like the Jahmiya. الَّذِينَ يُقَدِّمُونَ الْعَقْلَ عَقْلَ عَلَى النَّقْلِ. That were given precedence to logic and rationality over textual evidence. The Khawarij weren't like that. The Khawarij would say, Qala Allah, Qala Allah, Qala Allah, Qala Allah. That's what they'll say all day. So the person who wants to tackle their ideology has to be a person who gives importance to the Quran and the Sunnah. Not a group of people who themselves don't respect the Quran and the Sunnah. So Sufi can't argue and debate and confront these extremists. Nor can a Diobandi. Nor can a liberal Quilliam Foundation do that. The only people who can are the Salafis. Ahlul Sunnati wal Jama'ah are the only people. Because what they're going to do is, every verse that they bring, the Khawarij don't have any nusus from the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They break their backs with the hadith of the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam. Are you with me, brothers? Like, you look at the government, what do? They shut down the Salafis to counter these individuals. When in reality, the ones who can deal with them are them. Rather, they're the only ones who've ever dealt with them. From the time of the companions. Who were the people who were dealing with it? The people upon the Sunnah. Abdullah ibn Abbas was the one who was dealing with it. Qarnan ba'da qarn, generation after generation, the people who dealt with the Khawarij are who? Ya ikhwa, who were they? Look at the books of the Sunnah. Look at the books of Imam Ahmad rahimahullah. The books of Imam al-Bahari, Abu Bakr al-Ismaili, Qawam al-Sunnah, Abu Qasim al-Taymi, and others. They all dealt with the Khawarij in their books and refuted the ideologies of the Khawarij. Until Muhammad ibn Abdullah came and he refuted them and he blasted them, alayhi rahmatullah. ولذلك there's a kitab I advise you guys to read, written by Abu Salah al-Afghani. Sheikh Abu Salah al-Afghani is called Taqriratu A'immat al-Da'wat al-Najdiya. In refuting the Khawarij and their methodology. He wrote this is his PhD, I think. It's got the taqdeem of the Mufti, Abdulaziz al-Sheikh, on it. What he does is that he brings all of the kalam of the A'immat al-Da'wat al-Najdiya, proving that they refuted and they blasted the Khawarij. And they have nothing to do with them. And Sheikh Abu Salah al-Afghani, when he did this thesis, when he wrote it, the Mufti was part of the committee of Niqash. It was Lajnatul Niqash. The Mufti was there sitting, listening to his thesis and commented on it. And the audio is on YouTube. And the book is published. Al-Qa'idatu al-Thalitha wal-Ishirun. The 13th Qa'ida, the 23rd Qa'ida. أنهم يحثون على دراسة السنة النبوية والعمل بها ويحذرون من هجرها. From the قاعدة of أهل السنة والجماعة is what? They urge the people to study the Sunnah of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. They urge the people to what? To study the what? The Sunnah of the Messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام. The Sunnah of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. والعمل به and to implement it. وَيُحَذِّرُونَ مِنْ هَجْرِهَا And they warn the people from what? Boycotting the Sunnah of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. The Sunnah of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام is divided into two. عِلْمُ الْحَدِيثِ And the Sunnah of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام is what? رِوَايَةً And the second one is دِرَايَةً. عِلْمُ الْحَدِيثِ رِوَايَةً, right? رِوَايَة means narration-wise. The first one is called ilm al hadithi riwayatan. Riwaya means here narration. And there are three things that fall under that one. The first one, ilm al hadithi riwayatan, three things fall under it. Mustalah al hadith. Ama qawa'id al hadith, same thing. Mustalah al hadith, which is the science of hadith. Are you with me, brothers and sisters? Mustalah al hadith, which is what falls under, is called mustalah al hadith. And we recently took the kitab Nukhbatul Fikr, written by في مصطلح أهل الأثر written by who? حافظ ابن حجر العسقلاني رحمه الله. We studied that book. So we said the Sunnah of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, the Hadith of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم is divided into how much? Two. The first one is called علم الحديث رواية. علم الحديث in terms of what? The رواية. And we said that's divided into how much? It is divided into two, sorry. I said three, it's divided into, sorry, two. The first one is Mustalah al-Hadith. The first one is called Mustalah al-Hadith. And the first one whoever authored in this science of Mustalah al-Hadith is Abu Muhammad al-Ramahurmuziyu. Al-Ramahurmuziyu. His name is Abu Muhammad al-Ramahurmuziyu. He authored a book which he called it Al-Muhaddith al-Fasil. Al-Muhaddith al-Fasil. He's the first person who wrote in it. Are you with me, brothers and sisters? And then after him came Al-Imam Abu Abdullah Hakim al-Naysaburi rahimahullah. He authored his kitab al-Kifaya fi ilm al-Riwaya. And then after him came Al-Imam Abu Nu'aym Al-Asbahani rahimahullah. He wrote his kitab Al-Mustakhraj. And then after him came Al-Imam Khatib Al-Baghdadi And he wrote, and then after him came Al-Imam Abu Khatib al-Baghdadi, Hafiz ibn Hajar. He spoke about these three that I mentioned. The first one being Abu Muhammad al-Rama al-Muziyu in his Kitab al-Muhaddith al-Fasil, and the Kitab written by Al-Imam al-Khatib al-Baghdadi. And also, the Kitab by Khatib al-Baghdadi is called Al-Jami' al-Akhlaq al-Rawi wa Adab al-Sabi'. And the second one was who? The third one, sorry, is Al-Imam Abu Nu'aym al-Asbahani rahimahullah, in his Kitab is Mustakhraj. Are you with me, brothers? Mustakhraj. These three, I mentioned four. First one is Abu Muhammad al-Rama al-Hurmuziyu. The second one is Abu Abdullah Hakim al-Nisaburiyu. And the third one was Abu Nu'aym al-Asbahaniyu. Abu Nu'aym's Mustakhraj is basically taken from the Kitab written by Abu Abdullah Hakim al-Nisaburiyu. Hafiz ibn Hajar said about Abu Muhammad al-Rama al-Hurmuziyu, since he was the first one who authored it, he didn't really put the science in proper order. And then Abu Hakim al-Nisaburiyu, his one's also good, but he said the sequence and the way he structured it wasn't good. As for, what do you call it, Abu Nu'aym al-Asbahaniyu, his mustakhraj, Hafiz ibn Hajar said, he left room for somebody to come and add on to it. But the one he praised highly is the one written by Abu Bakr Khatib al-Baghdadi, rahimahullah. Abu Bakr Khatib al-Baghdadi's kitab is Jami' li-akhlaq al-rawi wa adab al-sami'. This kitab, he said, as he brought from Abu Bakr ibn Nuqta. Abu Bakr ibn Nuqta said, everybody who came and spoke about science of hadith after Khatib al-Baghdadi was in need of the works of Khatib al-Baghdadi. Because he wrote in every science. He spoke every particular issue of mustalah al-hadith, the science of hadith, he wrote about it. He wrote a particular book regarding it. And then after that came none other than the great noble Imam Ibn Salah. He wrote his Muqaddimah, is known as Ulum al-Hadith. When he wrote it, then every single body came and took from that. Al-Imam Hafiz Zainuddin al-Iraqi came, and what did he do? Hafiz Zainuddin al-Iraqi, who is the Sheikh of Hafiz ibn Hajar, he done poetry on the kitab written by Ibn Salah. Before Hafiz Zainuddin al-Iraqi was who? Before Zainuddin al-Iraqi was Ibn Kathir. Ibn Kathir done Ikhtisar Ulum al-Hadith. Ikhtisar Ulum al-Hadith is a summary of Ulum al-Hadith written by Ibn Salah. Also, Bulqini, rahimahullah, he did the same. No, Sirajuddin Bulqini, na'am, Bulqini, I'm a Bulqini, however you want to say it. And others. And then came the book that we studied, which is Nukhbatul Fikr, which Hafiz ibn Hajar wrote, which is then the book that everybody gave acceptance to. So that's the first of the two in Ilm al-Riwaya. The second one is Al-Jarh wa Ta'deel. Al-Jarh wa Ta'deel. Al-Jarh wa Ta'deel is criticism and praise of the narrators. And the scholars, they authored that in three ways. Al-Jarh wa Ta'deel was written in three ways. Are you with me, brothers? Books that talked about al-thiqat, the reliable narrators. And the second one is the praised narrators, the reliable and the praised ones are the first one. And the second one is the criticized narrators, al-du'afa, the weak narrators. And the third one is al-du'afa'i wa-thiqat. The criticized and the praised are all in there. And each and every one of them, many come out of it. Al-ilm al-jarh wa al-ta'deel can be categorized into two. A type which is nadari, which is more theoretical, which is that fulan is a wadda', he places narrations. Kadhab, fasiq, la yu'khadhu bi hadithi, laysa bi shay', la ba'sa bihi. That's all jarh wa al-ta'deel. Then the application side of it, which is basically ilal. That where you have now studied mustalah al-hadith, and then the person has studied what? Then the person has studied the jarh al-ta'deel, the criticism, the praise, and the best book written in ilal by consensus of the ulama, it is the best, nothing has been seen the likes of it, is the kitab written by al-imam al-Dharqutni rahimahullah, which is called al-ilal al-warida. That book is the best. لا مثيل له. And wallahi, it's amazing because that kitab is over 10 volumes. And Imam Dar-Qutni wrote it from his memory. He wrote it all from his memory. All of it came from his head. He criticized, he questions, he speaks about narrations, and all of it was written from the top of Al-Imam Dar-Qutni's head. Alayhi rahmatullah. He was something else, Al-Imam Dar-Qutni. Something else. Something else. Rahimahullahu rahmatan wasi'a. And also, what the practical side is, as you see today, manifested many books, ilm al-takhrij, the takhrij of ahadith. Many books have been written in that. One of the books that are great in takhrij, if you want to see, takhrij means when you read a book, takhrij is different from tahqiq, by the way. Many people confuse the two. Takhrij doesn't mean that the person gives you the ruling of the hadith. It just means that he brings all of the narrations in that particular hadith for you. Every different riwayat and different narrations regarding that hadith. There are many books that are written in that regard. From the books that are written in it is Al-Badr al-Munir, written by Ibn Mulaqqin, who's the Shaykh of Hafiz ibn Hajar. Are you with me? Ibn Mulaqqin wrote a book, Badr al-Munir. And Badr al-Munir is basically fi takhriji hadith Sharh al-Kabir, written by Al-Rafi'i. And then he summarized his own book, Al-Imam Ibn Mulaqqin summarized his own book. And also the same book, Hafiz ibn Hajar also worked on it, which is a nice kutub takhrij book. It's called Talqis al-Habir. Fi takhriji hadith hadith al-Rafi'i al-Kabir. It's also by Ibn Hajar. It's the same book. He done takhrij of the hadith of Sharh al-Kabir by al-Rafi'i. He came and he went put takhrij on it. From the books that are in that particular field is, and I'm going fast, brothers, because I'm mentioning fast, is Nasb al-Raya by Imam Zayla'i rahimahullah, which is takhrij on kitab Hidayah, written by Al-Marghinani, which is a Hanafi kitab. And Imam Zayla'i rahimahullah, he has done takhrij on that book. Also from that is Albani rahimahullah, Muhammad Nasir al-Din al-Albani rahimahullah, his kitab Irwa' al-Ghalil, fi takhrij hadith Manar al-Sabil. The kitab Manar al-Sabil is a Hanbali kitab. Albani came rahimahullah and he done takhrij of all the ahadith which they use. One of the books I forgot also is the great, amazing kitab At-Tanqih wa At-Tahqiq fi Ahadith At-Ta'liq by Hafiz ibn Abdul Hadi rahimahullah. Hafiz ibn Abdul Hadi, he does takhrij on the ahadith al-ahkam that was gathered by Ibn al-Jawzi rahimahullah. He does tahqiq of it. It's an amazing kitab written by them. Anyways, Ahl al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah, and the other one is ilm al-hadithi dirayatan. Ilm al-hadithi dirayatan means understanding the ahadith, fiqh al-ahadith. So they tell the people to go to what? Books like Bulugh al-Maram. Have you studied Bulugh al-Maram? Then go for Umdatul Ahkam. Have you now studied Umdatul Ahkam? Then now go for the kutubs that are written like Al-Muharrar, Ibn Abdul Hadi, Al-Muntaqa, Limajdiddin, Abu al-Barakat. Of course, you go for the different explanations of these books. For example, Al-Muntaqa, you go to say Kitab Naylul Awtar by Imam Shawkani, rahimahullah. Bulugh al-Maram, you go for the different shuruh and the different explanations there are. Well, the earliest of it being Subul al-Salam, written by Amir al-San'ani, rahimahullah, and those who came after him, who then took from him. Each sharah of Bulugh al-Maram, you try to look at it. You see, and you go for the books of Hadith al-Ahkam after that, such as the Kitab Sunan Abi Dawood. Al-Imam Abi Dawood's Kitab, his Sunan, is from the Ahadith al-Ahkam. Ahadith al-Ahkam are basically what? Ahadith which are just about jurisprudent rulings. So you take the fiqhiyat from it. Al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah push the people to study those books. And they say you study those books so you can learn the Sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And they warn the people from staying away from the hadith of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Then you go for the other books of hadith. One of the biggest books in Kutub al-Hadith al-Ahkam, if not the biggest, is Sunan al-Kubra by Bayhaqi. It's the biggest. That is the biggest Ahadith al-Ahkam book. It's written by who? Al-Imam al-Bayhaqi, rahimahullah ta'ala. So I would urge every one of you, if you could go and look at buy that book, the Kitab Sunan al-Kubra by Bayhaqi, rahimahullah ta'ala. So what was this qa'ida again? Ahl al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah, they urge the people, and they push the people to study in the ahadith of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam and the sunnah of the Prophet. وَالْعَمَلَ بِهِ And they what? They tell the people to implement it. So if you study something and you learn it, what are you going to do? You're going to implement it. وَيُحَذِّرُونَ مِنْ هَجِّرِهَا And they warn the people from boycotting the hadith of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Now you find a war against the Prophet's sunnah. You find a person, he's studying fiqh, he's never ever studied a book of hadith on fiqh. He's never studied Bulugh al-Maram, مثلاً. Or he hasn't studied any books of hadith al-ahkam. All day he's doing, he's saying, Abu Thawr said this, Laytham ibn Sa'ad said this, Ahmed said this, Shafi'i said this, Malik said this, but he doesn't have any narration what the Prophet did. And this is what we will, wallahi brothers, is deficiency and it's weakness. You have to give importance to the dirasa to sunnati nabawiyyah, studying the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's sunnah. Al-Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, he chaptered a bab in his sahih. Write this down, very important. Al-Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, he chaptered a bab in his sahih. He called it, كَيْفَ يُقْبَضُ الْعِلْمُ How will knowledge be taken? And I want you to understand this. Al-Imam al-Bukhari chaptered in his sahih a chapter. And he wrote there, كَيْفَ يُقْبَضُ الْعِلْمُ How will knowledge be taken? وَكَتَبَ عُمَرُ بْنُ عَبْدِ الْعَزِيزَ إِلَىٰ أَبِي And then this is what he brings. Al-Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah brings this. وكتب عمر بن عبد العزيز إلى أبي بكر بن حزم. عمر بن عبد العزيز he wrote to who? This noble Imam Abu Bakr ibn Hazm. Imam عمر بن عبد العزيز the great noble تابعي what did he do? He wrote towards to who? Abu Bakr ibn Hazm. And look what he said to him. He said انظر ما كان من حديث رسول الله فاكتبه. عمر بن عبد العزيز wrote to him and said to him, look that which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's hadiths are, and write it. Look and basically research the ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and write them. فَإِنِّي خِفْتُ دُرُوسَ الْعِلْمِ وَذِهَابَ الْعُلَمَاءِ For I am scared that knowledge will wear out and the scholars will go. وَلَا تُقْبَلْ إِلَّا حَدِيثَ النَّبِي sallallahu alaihi wasallam And it will not be accepted. And it will not be accepted from us except the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So what he said was, "Unzur, look at ma kana min hadith Rasulillah. Look at the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Faktubhu and write it. Research and look for the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And write it." فَإِنِّي خِفْتُ I am scared. دُرُوسَ الْعِلْمِ That knowledge will go and the scholars are also going to go. So what did he consider knowledge is going to go? By the hadith of the Prophet going. If the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ goes, knowledge is going to go. Al-Imam ibn al-Qayyim said, in his kitab, اِجْتِبَعُ جُيُوشِ الْإِسْلَامِيَّةِ Ibn al-Qayyim said, فَإِنَّ السُّنَّةَ حِصْنُ اللَّهِ الْحَصِينِ Ibn al-Qayyim said that the sunnah is the fortress of Allah. It's a fortress. You know, if you're in a fortress, you're protected from the outer harm. The sunnah is a fortress. مَنْ دَخَلَهُ Anyone who enters into that fortress, كَانَ مِنَ الْآمِنِينَ That person is from the safe people. They're going to be saved, right? So what is the sunnah? Is a fortress that protects the people. Once that fortress goes, my beloved brothers and sisters, once that fortress goes, what's going to happen? Which is the sunnah. Then you're vulnerable. Anyone can attack you. Your religion can be attacked. Everything. That's why it's powerful that the person studies the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah said something very powerful. He said, وَهَذَا سَبَبُ ظُهُورِ الْبِدَعِ فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةِ The reason, Ibn Taymiyyah says, and this is the reason why innovation became clear and it became out and apparent in the Ummah. Sorry, in every nation. Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah says, the reason why innovation became clear in every nation is because, هُوَ خَفَاءُ السُّنَنِ الْمُرْسَلِينَ فِيهِمْ The sunnah of each prophet was hidden from the people. It got hidden from the people. وَبِذَٰلِكَ يَقَعُ الْهَلَاكِ And because of that, destruction occurs. وَلِهَذَا كَانُوا يَقُولُونَ And because of that, the Salaf used to say, الْاِعْتِصَامُ بِالسُنَّةِ نَجَاتِ Holding onto the sunnah is what success is. Why were every previous nation destroyed? Because they were, the sunnah of the Prophet, their prophets was missing from them. And when the sunnah of every prophet is absent from any nation, the destruction is what comes to them next. Inshallah ta'ala, we're going to take 15 minutes break and then we're going to go into the next qa'idah. Inshallah ta'ala.